When I was 7 years old, I was living in a small village of 5,000 residents in northern Italy. In my class, I was the only one to have a weird name. In the whole village, there was just two Arab families, and every time I needed to explain the reason of my weird name, why I sometimes eat couscous, where Morocco is, I needed to explain that my dad loves me, that he didn't hate women just because he's a Muslim. Then suddenly, September 11, 21 happened. The day after, I went to school. I saw the news, but I, like every other kid, didn't pay so much attention. I was barely aware of the United States capital city. But at the beginning of the lesson, the teacher stopped me and asked me in front of the whole class, "Imen, what did you think about what happened? Why you Arabs hate us?" And in that moment, for the first time in my life, I felt very different from the others. I went back home shocked, and for days, I wasn't able to even speak to my friends. At the time, Facebook didn't yet exist. But can you guess what would have happened if my mom and dad have reported the episode on social media? What kind of comments would have been written under the post? Certainly, the teacher would have received insults, and also my parents would have received them too, for sure. And this is the polarization we are living in today. Today, we live in a world that has never been so connected. We can easily reach millions of people in a few hours with a post. And yet, we have never been so divided. We found divisions in everything, in politics, economy, society, civil rights, environment. Division has always been with us. The issue is that nowadays, because of social media, they can spread faster than ever. This graph illustrates the political polarization of the United States from 1994 to 2017. As you can see, there are two blocks, one in blue, Democrats, one in red, Republicans. The two blocks have moved away from each other more and more over the years. Surveys show that the large majorities of Americans, both Democrats and Republicans, think that the other side is not just mistaken, but is a threat to the nation. And that conflict prevents us from finding a common ground to change things. We see those who disagree with us as idiots or incompetent. And guess who realized it very well? Politicians. Politicians all over the world have found in the social polarization a political market to conquer. And here we have another graph. Again, we have two blocks. It shows interactions on Twitter. In red, again, we have Republicans, and in blue, the progressive bloc. The University of New York conducted a study to analyze how often people of opposing political ideologies retweet one another. The researchers created a network graph where nodes represent users who sent out a tweet, and edges between users represent a user retweeting another user. The resulting graph reveals that in terms of retweeting one another, Twitter users of opposing political leanings are relatively isolated from one another. Overall, no interaction and no debates. Each bloc keeps interacting with the members of the same bloc. Each one stays in their own bubble with people having the same opinions. This means that, for example, Trump supporters will keep supporting him wherever the scandal is, while his opponents, on the other side, will keep denigrating him despite his successes. And this is exactly how social media works. Social media are a massive network that aim to create as many interactions as possible. And the more interactions, the more the business increases. And the interactions take place more easily among similar people rather than different individuals. And so we believe that the other world doesn't even exist, or that it's completely wrong just because it's different from us and our community. I work in social media. I founded a media company, and I'm an activist. Communicating is my job. I spend all my days trying to understand how to deliver a message. Journalists and digital creators usually want one thing: to become viral. So the framework is exactly this one: divide and polarize. If I say Trump is a traitor, I would quickly get many likes and retweets from the people who are close to me, so I will be viral in my same blog, but at the same time, I would trigger many interactions from the other side as well, who would comment against me, accusing me of faking news or being a sellout. So once my content became viral, what have I achieved aside from creating further divisions and likes? Have I been able to bring real change to others? How can I send out a message that is truly addressed to everyone? What is the remedy able to fix this? What is the social glue? Empathy. Empathy is the ability to put yourself, ourselves, in someone else's shoes, to see the world through those who are different from us. And so empathy increases when we connect with people who are different from us. If we could understand the feelings and the perspectives of our opponents, perhaps we might be able to find more common ground and reduce partisan acrimony. In one of his speeches, Barack Obama said, "The first lesson of growing up is that the world doesn't just revolve around you." We live in a culture that discourages empathy. A culture that too often tells us that our principal goal in life is to be rich, famous, young, beautiful. A culture that tells that they will tell you that the poor are poor because they are too lazy and no one can force you to care of this. But you can live without taking care of the others, without talking to your neighbors. However, we have to remember that our individual salvation depends on collective salvation. Think about all the latest social movements. What do they have in common? Aren't they all demanding empathy? The Friday for Future kids asks politicians to empathize with future generations, and the Black Lives Matter movement asks to understand the deep inequalities suffered by the Black community. The Arab Spring asks its leader to empathize with the needs of the people. However, to empathize with someone does not mean to be on the side who is more vulnerable. It means to empathize also with your enemies. A perfect example of this is Nelson Mandela. Empathy and humanity made Nelson Mandela great. He was a giant of empathy, able to look to his opponents during the negotiations over the South Africa's future. He could see human beings, their histories, their own desire for dignity. Peace talks, Mandela said, succeed when connections are freely made and all parties believe that they have won more than they have lost. dictators and ultimatums are good for starting a war, not for searching peace. Nothing is black or white, he said. But to gain more electoral consensus, the easiest thing to do is to split the world into good and evil. It's easy. It's easier to divide people, much harder to put together different factions and try to achieve long-term agreements. Life is never black or white. Decisions are complex. Nothing is as it appears. Mandela's calculus was always, why is the end? What is the end of what I seek? What is the most practical way to get there? I will give you an example. I'm a feminist. I often speak about women and gender inequalities. I do it with data, numbers, to be as objective as possible. And yet, very often, people in front of me have a different opinion about it. Not only women, but women, not only men, but women too. So I wonder, what has led these people to have a different opinion from mine? I tried to acknowledge that humanity of someone who has raised to think very different from me. But when I did this, when I did this exercise, I used to feel vulnerable. I can feel very vulnerable to be empathizing with someone who profoundly disagrees with me. So I established a helpful mantra. Empathy is not endorsement. Empathizing with someone who profoundly disagrees with you does not subtly compromise your own deep beliefs and endorse theirs. Empathizing with someone who believes that gender equality does not exist doesn't mean that I'm subtly compromising my own beliefs. It just means that I'm trying to understand the other's way of thinking and my way of thinking. I try to remember what convinced me to think in that way, so I can propose it to them too. Neuroscientists said that we are designed to connect, to communicate, to build empathy. We are born with empathy. We just need to improve it. Empathy increases when we connect with people different from us. It requires a physical effort to step out of our comfort zone. But whenever we do it, we feel great. We feel enriched and good about ourselves. So I leave you with this challenge. The next time you try to dismiss someone who disagrees with you as an idiot, think about the feelings that help you to get where you are. Be radically open-minded. Don't be prejudicial. Listen to others. Be curious. The hard work is finding a common ground. And empathy is the way, the only way, to challenge the us versus them mentality. Thank you.